What is up, everybody? My name is James D. Fiore, and this is Blackballed. It has been a Plymouth Brethren marathon here on Blackballed this week. We started off with a international exclusive. It's so funny to saying that because we're still trying to introduce people to who this group is. But an international exclusive where we heard the voice of Plymouth Brethren Christian Church, aka the Plymouth Brethren crazy cult leader, Bruce Hales, try to, let's just say, shake the ankles of his localities so that money would fall out of the pockets to the tune of $500 million. What was amazing is that we, and this is something I'm sort of learning as I go. I don't like, my appreciation for this is certainly not as strong as the ex-members, but apparently hearing this man's voice is just like, I can't believe we just heard Bruce's voice. That's crazy. Because apparently it's really rare for people outside the localities, and even the people within it, I think, it's not like a regular occurrence, but I could be wrong. And then we followed the story that was broke by the CBC, where the Human Rights Museum in Winnipeg had granted the censorship request of a couple of Brethren schools from, what is it, the One School Global, I believe it's called. And that was an interesting story. Just enough dander to make you itch and want to scratch some more, but not really all that surprising given who we're talking about. Today, we have a gentleman who, if I woke up tomorrow as a member of the Plymouth Brethren Christian Church and I woke up in some locality that I would soon set fire to, mind you, I would probably be similar to this man, according to Richard and Cheryl, because I asked the question the other day, well, why don't we just ask Bruce why he's not giving any of his money? And they'd be like, well, because then you'd be ostracized for the rest of your life. And I didn't know that. And so we have an example of that tonight, from what I understand. And his name is Peter Hart. And joining us as well is Cheryl Hope. Peter, Cheryl, how are you guys?
Good.
Yeah, I'm good. Yeah.
Peter, it's very lovely to meet you. I have heard a lot about you. I don't know where to begin. Can you tell me, first of all, where you're hailing from and where you were when you were with the Brethren and sort of where you were born and how all that worked out?
Yeah, so I'm from Wellington, New Zealand. I've been here all my life. I was a happy member until Bruce appeared on the scene. I sort of saw through him right from the beginning, really. He was quite different to the others, and I sort of saw him as a selfish sort of person, really. He talked about himself a lot. It is very unempathetic. He sort of couldn't see past the end of his nose. And he wasn't well taught in the scriptures. He very obviously loved money, because he also talked, if he wasn't talking about himself, he was talking about money. And yeah, he brought back what all the Brethren know as the system days, which was what his father and his uncle were doing in the 60s. He brought back that on steroids.
What was happening in the 60s with his dad?
Oh, his dad and his uncle were encouraging the Brethren to make lots of money and also do lots of Bible study. Basically, overachieve, you know, sort of be high achievers. Mm. Yeah.
I've always been extended to the housewives.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I was going to say, I've always been curious if there was some sort of mathematics between the relationship of heavy religious, you know, orthodoxy whatever, you know, the those rules that I find draconian, like you can't break bread with other people because they have cooties or whatever the fuck. And then, you know, just the excommunication and all that. Was that religious, you know, strident kind of like protocols, was that seen as something that helped assist them make money?
Well, I guess so. I mean, they were so limited in what they could do. You weren't allowed, I'm not sure about the 60s. I think in the 60s too, you weren't allowed to go away on holidays, and basically you weren't allowed to have fun. So yeah, but you weren't allowed to make money. So I guess that was sort of the most fun you could have. So yeah, it caught on pretty quick. And it's the same today. The most fun you can have is make money and spend it.
Because it's so mafia. Like it's set up kind of like a mafia. I'm not really talking about the international UBTs, but I refer to, I think it's Brad Mitchell, as like a capo, right? Like he's the guy in Canada who kind of is like the top brethren guy in Canada, if I'm not mistaken, right? Mm-hmm. And I call him like, he's like a captain of a mafia crew. So he's like the top of the pyramid in this country, but he still has a boss. And the big boss is Tony Soprano, AKA Bruce Hales, who up until a few years ago literally got paid an envelope stuffed full of cash, which is exactly how Tony Soprano gets paid. Like it was set up. So you've had like, you've been in the same room as this person. You say he talks about money and himself. Does he seem godly at all behind the curtain, or is it just completely 100% a grift for him?
Oh, no, he appears godly. And I think, you know, of a type, I guess. And he also talks about con men a bit. You know, he probably several times a year he referred to con men. Well, he's the biggest con man of all.
He knows it, though. There's no way he pinches planks before he goes to bed at night and doesn't realize that he's a scam artist. It's impossible.
Yeah, so it's quite interesting how he talks about con men, because he's got all his listeners thinking, oh, you know, we wouldn't want to be caught by a con man. And they're not thinking for a second that he's a con man.
Yeah.
Then that's a psychological thing. That's like the serial killer helping with the search, you know?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. if you don't mind me asking, how old are you now and how old were you when you left, and what were the circumstances sort of behind that specifically?
How old do you think I am?
I think you're 42, okay? I think you're 42 years old.
That's hilarious.
I have no idea, man. I really
don't. I'm 54. I was 52 when I left.
Okay. Oh, wow. So it's fresh. You still have that new life smell, right? Like it's like So can you tell me so that was only a couple years ago. So you said you were sort of a senior level when Bruce arrived. Were you summarily demoted, or how did that work out?
Oh, I wasn't senior level. I was never important.
Okay.
But I was quite happy. I fully believed in the Christian. I mean, in the brethren thing, and I'm still a Christian. I haven't given that up, but I've definitely given up the whole idea of the brethren thing. One thing they taught. Sorry.
I said you got rid of the cult.
Yeah, that's right. One thing they taught in that day in there was that, you know, the idea of the Paul of our day is that the Apostle Paul in the Bible was currently on earth, and he's embodied in Bruce. Well, I just didn't like that idea. I didn't think that was all intelligent.
One second. Who came up with that idea?
I think JT Jr. came up with the idea that he was the one that took over in 59.
Right.
And he's the one that had a fascination on a woman half his age in 1970.
That's where Aberdeen happened, James.
That's right. Yeah.
Okay.
Split.
Yeah. Okay. So he's like an, in the same family tree as Paul. That's what they're saying.
Well, he is the current day Paul. In fact, often they'll in their church meetings, they'll say Paul said this and Paul said that.
But just so I'm clear, it's not the lineage itself. It's just that he represents the same idea as Paul.
That's right, yeah. Okay. If you say Paul said this or Paul said that, you actually You mean aka Bruce did this or that?
I'm so happy that it's not lineage, because I'd be writing about that shit for like weeks. I would just wouldn't stop. I was like, how the fuck is this possible? Like, you know, isn't this enough to not do business with him? He says he's the offspring of Paul. Like, you know, I don't know. Okay, so sorry, I keep derailing because we're gonna watch a video soon that I got just before we went on air. And I was so happy that I did smoke a little joint. And I had to, because it's that funny. So it's going to be a little bit lighthearted, despite the dark story that you're about to embark on, Peter. But, you know, I hope you still tell it with as much passion as you would if I wasn't giggling. But I need to know. So take us up to speed then. What were the circumstances that sort of precipitated your departure?
Well, I was a bit of a black sheep for like the last 10, 12 years or so. We had a few incidences where I asked some pretty gnarly questions and just about got kicked out. And then finally my wife said to me, look, you've got to sort of sort your shit out and talk to the elders, which I wasn't at all keen to do because I knew where that would end. And I was shut up. About 5 or 6 weeks later, I was kicked out because I was questioning Mr. Bruce, Mr. Hales. And also I talked to a person who was no longer in the fellowship, and I wouldn't tell them who. I refused to tell them who it was because that particular person didn't want any more shit from the brethren. So it was pretty fast towards the end. And it was a one-way
street. So it's like insubordination in their eyes.
Sorry?
I said it was sort of like insubordination in their eyes, basically.
Yeah.
Yeah, but you also did it once during an actual meeting, like an actual church meeting, you questioned something, right?
They were saying that Jesus only goes to brethren meetings. He doesn't turn up at any other church at all. and I said, no, you can't tell Jesus where to go. And the whole meeting imploded, and they just threw bricks at me for the rest of the church meeting. There's about 380 people there.
Wow. I'm
Peter's my new hero.
Peter, I love you. You can come back anytime you want. Seriously, because if I ever imagine myself in that role, like I said, I what would I do if Bruce Hales or anybody said that, oh, Jesus only comes here? I would probably be like, I just need to ask you a question. It is the most narcissistic thing I can ever think of for a religious person to do, you know, and it's good on you, you know.
Well, that really pissed me off, because I knew there's lots of good Christians out there, and they believe that Jesus goes to their church. And I thought, well, you know, what a bunch of proud people we are, saying that Jesus only comes here.
What was wrong with the old idea that God is everywhere? You know, isn't that like the way that I'm not a religious person. I'm just saying that was more welcoming. You know, that seemed like a pretty just God. He's like, oh, he's every little peeping Tomish perhaps. But, you know, other than that, like, you know, there was a sort of semblance of equality among people. Like, we all have the same access or not, right, to God, whoever we think is God. And
the funny thing about that whole thing was that before I said it, I knew what I was talking about, because the first three leaders of that church had said exactly what I said. And I had it in black and white. And so after that meeting, I had to come before the elders, and they told me I said the wrong thing. I had to apologize. And I said, but here it is, it's in black and white. And they said, yeah, but Bruce isn't saying that currently. That's not what Bruce is saying. And so I had to apologize.
Directly or through the elders?
I had to apologize in that. A couple of nights later in that church meeting, I had to apologize.
And was Bruce there?
No, he wasn't
there. Oh, okay.
No, but he did come back to Wellington a few months later, and he referred to something about dropping a bomb into a meeting or something. I wonder if he was talking about me.
Probably, I'm certain he was. You're freshly out. I'm super curious. I've asked this from I think Dennis Reg and Richard and a few others. Cheryl, I don't think I really asked you this because the answer was obvious. But the question is, do you recall the person that you were when you were engrossed in side brethren culture? And do you recognize that person now, or is it the same guy who's grown? I know, like, you know, I'm trying to figure out the sort of contrast, or is it just like, I don't even recognize that person the way I was, you know, like, what is your story, your backstory in how you've evolved in all this?
Sorry, are you asking Cheryl or me?
No, I'm asking you, Peter.
Oh, well, I had to change. I was a bit of a prick, you know, in the early days. I was quite religious earlier on, fully in support of the Brethren movement. And yeah, so I did need to change.
Yeah.
And yeah, but I never got important. I don't think I ever hurt anyone. I wasn't that sort of person. I sort of liked to protect the underdog. Yeah. But which is why I probably got into a lot of trouble, because I stood up for people. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I did need to change, if that answers your question.
Well, you spent half a century inside, if you were born in it, right?
Yeah.
So yeah. That would be the only life you know. Like, it's like, you know, the adjustment must have been massive. You're probably still in a lot of ways adjusting, no? Like, do you reflexively get a little bit of a jolt of anxiety when you see a woman's knee? Do you know?
Like,
oh my gosh.
Oh, right,
it's fine.
No, I'll say more than the woman's knee.
Yeah, thank you. I'm sure you have. You look 42 after all. Cheryl, you got out when you were fairly young, and thank God you did, obviously. But you told me about Peter, and you said, you know, that his backstory is really interesting, because no one that you know has ever really, like, talked back to the sort of hierarchical structure inside the Brethren. Like, this is rare, which is hilarious, because in society it's the most common thing that we do, which is talk shit about our, you know, about our superiors, right? So it's interesting.
Yeah, I like to align myself with brave, courageous people that aren't afraid to call a spade and bring things out like they are. And so, I mean, I had watched Peter comment on the Facebook page on Facebook, and he always had this sharp wit about him. And so it was a no-brainer. We did his podcast. It hasn't aired yet, but we did a podcast with him that was, I really enjoyed. And so I knew he needed to come on here and share this quick-witted humor he has about how he went up against them. And I mean, I think it takes incredible bravery to do something like that.
Yeah. What were your thoughts about Peter, about the Bruce Hales recording that we were able to acquire and play, the significance of that? As Cheryl and Richard have communicated, is significant. It's just rare that you would hear his voice. How rare is it, and what do you think they're saying over there at the home base of the elders or whatever?
Well, as far as hearing his voice goes, once you get out, the longer you're out, the more you think, how on earth do they believe all that bullshit? But then once you hear his voice, you think, yeah, I can understand that. He's got something, you know, something about them, but people just believe it. And when you're in there, and like I was saying before, he's a con man. He just sucks people in. And he's sort of persuasive. You might not understand it, but I do.
No, well, I didn't at the time that I first heard it, but when Cheryl was talking the last, when we played it, she was saying, like, you know, he knows how to butter their bread. Right. Like he knows how to. And I think I listened to it. Like, I've listened to it about 20 times, honestly, because I'm just sort of like closing my eyes and just listening to this man talk. And the one thing that did strike me is that he has this very, like, casual, matter of fact certainty behind his words, where he's saying it like it's 1 + 1 = 2.
Yeah.
And that is something I finally sort of clued in on sort of his style delivery. Maybe it was the accent that threw me. I don't know. But it just, it didn't feel the same, you know, kind of persuasiveness that I associate with cult leaders. And now it does, because I like I said, he has that like the assuranceness behind his tone. Like, he's just so, you know, mathematical in the way that he talks, and I can see how that can be compelling to people, especially people who are sheltered their whole lives.
Yeah, and people genuinely believe that if Jesus was on Earth, he would look like Bruce Hales.
Yeah,
that they genuinely believe that.
That's blasphemous.
I don't believe Jesus was ugly, but people believe he would look like Bruce, and he would sound like him.
Pasty so and think, bloated. Like, I don't think so. Jesus walked around.
No, I don't either.
You know, like.
I remember an older woman saying to me once, we were talking about, well, she was talking about John Hales. I wasn't really. She said, he's so handsome, isn't he? It's Bruce's father. And I said, no, I don't think so. She was shocked, you know, because you don't talk like that. People are just, they're just absolutely bespotted by these people, these men. And, yeah, people really think that, like people say, oh, the face of Bruce Hales is the face of Jesus. That's what they literally say.
And, wow.
Yeah.
Like the Shroud of Turin.
So it's his voice, too. They really believe it's Jesus' voice.
Mm-hmm.
That's crazy. You know, the fundamentalist Christians in the United States that are all like the evangelicals, their version of Jesus, I just learned this in the last couple of years when I watched the documentary series called The Family, I think it's called. And it's all about the structure of Christian fundamentalism and the organizations that they run and how they use that to push issues and everything. And their version of Jesus is like a Navy SEAL, like a tough, chiseled chin, heroic military guy. Like that's what the Jesus that they peddle. So it's really funny how Jesus is all these incarnations, is depending on like who you're representing. So what kind of tactics, if any, and or shenanigans did they try to pull on you after you left? Like, what kind of, how was their behavior towards you?
I think I was followed because I had, like, I was told that we saw you having coffee, you know, here and there. Well, I actually had coffee with very few people because I knew very few people, and they were in very random places. So I'm pretty sure I was followed. And there was a weird guy turned up. So I went to church pretty soon because I knew Lindy. I contacted her pretty quick, and I went to a church pretty quick. And this chap, random chap, just turned up because the church she goes to has open doors. And this random guy turned up, and people questioned him afterwards, and he sort of took off pretty fast. We thought he was probably there to sort of identify me as going to a church, because going to another church is a really bad sin. And one of the reasons I got shut up first, and then I got withdrawn from. And I found out later on that one of the reasons they withdrew from me is because I had gone to another church. But that's a really bad thing to do.
Yeah.
Because Jesus wouldn't be there, of course.
I'm sorry, the bloated, pasty white guy is not here right now.
You called them out on some stuff, though. Like, I know you had sent a screenshot. You called them out on a blatant lie that they had put together.
Well, that's about the court cases. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you left a lot of family behind, though, too, didn't you?
Yeah. My wife and five children. And since I left, I had another two grandchildren, which they did tell me about one of them, but the latest grandchild, I wasn't told about that, and I don't know her name.
They broke the rules and spoke to you a couple times?
No, it's only, of course, when I was shut up, they're allowed to communicate a bit. Once you withdraw from them, they're not allowed to. And of course, if you're an opposer, there's absolutely no communication at all.
Yeah. I'm really sorry, man. Like that is the thing that has struck me the most often when speaking with ex-members, people like Dennis, you know, and people like Richard and yourself mm-hmm. now, like the just the amount of blood left behind, and there's no really good reason for it. And that to me is one of those, it's one of those aspects that I'm wondering if we could ever find a way in the legal system to create yeah. a criminal charge for, mm-hmm. you know, I don't know how to do it. I know that we Western nations like ours, Peter, and yours, and, you know, the UK, they find a way to not just finagle, but to basically weaponize the freedom of religion and freedom of expression mm-hmm. to protect them from how they, you know, raise children and treat women and things like that. And I you know, I'm really sorry that you had to bear the brunt of it. Have either of you ever heard of, I think someone was telling me, Cheryl, who's that cult expert that I had on that was the ex-cult member, the woman?
Dr. Lalich.
Yes, Dr. Lalich. Yes. And she was talking about how they, there is some sort of law regarding coercion.
Yeah, it's the coercion control law that is trying to be brought in. It was brought in Peter, do you know about this? Is it New South? Man, it was brought in somewhere, but it didn't cover groups. It just covered
individual
families. Yeah. Individual. Yeah, it didn't cover groups. And so I don't know of a coercion law that covers groups. I've researched even with my therapist to try and find a way, because I asked my therapist, like, how do we do this? Like, put me in touch with people on how I can start the process of bringing in a coercion control that covers groups. And she said, my suggestion is to find somebody who's got it done already in another country and copy it. But there's nobody that's got it.
Yeah, I have looked into it. It has, different religions have tried it, like people who have been kicked out, they have tried it. And one thing the Brethren do, of course, very early on, that they made it clear, and they made it clear in emails back and forward. You know, we had very few emails, so they hate emails because it's in writing. But they made it clear to me that it's my family's decision not to talk to me. It's got nothing to do with the Brethren. They tried to make that legally clear. And of course, my poor family has got no choice, because if they talk to me, they'll get kicked out.
That's the sinister part of it all.
Yeah, then of course they'll lose contact with their extended family. Like my wife won't see her grandchildren, and so on and so forth. They've gotten by the balls, unfortunately. Yeah.
The thing is Bruce, he has his doctrine set out in them very, very well. So he can go ahead and say that, and they know not to even challenge it, right? Or you end up in Peter Hart's position. And I mean, it's just like the article that came out today. I don't know if anybody's seen it, but this is article that came out today. And really had just, it was just a bunch of BS of how this whole locality was shut down and spread out. And it was to do with the flood, and it was to do with, I mean, the whole article was a bunch of bullshit. You know that there was a political disagreement there that, and Bruce would have guided that. I mean, I really wanted to get a hold of one of the lads that were quoted in there and have him come on and talk, because he actually had gotten word from his mom that his mom was crying. She didn't want to go. So
was this all the real estate that was recently sold in Sydney? Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah. In Windsor, it's just outside of Sydney. Yeah. And I mean, big deal about the floods. That's what insurance is for. It's a political thing. And the Brethren spokesman said that the members can go to whichever locality they choose to go to, which is just hilarious, because Bruce will be saying where most of them can go, and you have to do what you're told, of course.
I mean, it's just the same thing that happened with the whole Museum of Human Rights, right? So they go ahead and they say all these things until they're caught, right?
Yeah.
That's the just Bruce is the biggest con man teaching everybody else how to be a con man. And nobody realizes that this is a whole complete con man of group of all these con people and con artists of how to speak to the public and how to get away with what they're getting away with. That's why the last article that came out today about the Human Rights Museum was written way more.
Well, it was an editorial. It was not a news article. It was an editorial. You know, they were these guys are haters.
Yeah, he was way more blunt. And that's how, it's exactly why I got so fired up last night, is because we've got to quit pussyfooting around all this. We've got to quit sitting in our seats and figuring out, oh, what's going to go happen next? Oh, has Cheryl been served yet? Or nobody's going to come and sue me. Nobody's going to come and sue Peter.
Well, they got to sue me first, Cheryl, because because on that, we can still be funny, though, right? And so, someone sent me this today. It's a possibility. I might stop in the middle, talk some shit, and then come back to it. But like, it is funny. If you guys remember, and most of the audience that wasn't in a cult until 2 years ago know about the Hitler meme, you know, the from that movie where it's like a 5 minute clip. And it was been memed to death, and people just put their political issue on it. And it's hilarious if you write it well. Well, I would like you to feast your eyes on the following. And we'll be back in a second. But I'm sorry for the people that are only listening. But you can imagine the Hitler meme because you've seen it a million times, as we all have.
Dem Feind gelungen, die Front in breiter Formation zu durchbrechen. Im Süden hat der Gegner Zossen genommen und stößt auf Stahnsdorf vor. Der Feind operiert jetzt am nördlichen Stadtrand zwischen Frohnau und Pankow und im Osten ist der Feind bis zur Linie Lichtenberg-Marsdorf-Karlshorst gelangt.
Mit dem Angriff Steiners wird das alles in Ordnung kommen.
Mein Führer, Steiner konnte nicht genügend Kräfte für einen Angriff massieren. Der Angriff Steiner ist nicht erfolgt.
David Wallace makes an appearance just some out of nowhere. So funny.
Es bleiben im Raum Keitel, Jodel, Krebs Das war ein Befehl! Der Angriff Steiners war ein Befehl! Wer schickt sie?
Das hier ist Wagen! Sie mein Befehl zu ihr setzen! Das ist einfach gekommen. Das Militär hat mich belogen!
Jeder hat mich belogen, sogar die SS! Die gesamte Generalität ist nichts weiter als ein Haufen niederträchtiger, treuloser Feiglinge!
Mein Führer, ich kann nicht zulassen, dass die Soldaten, die für Sie verbringen...
Ist das Feiglinge! Verreiter, Versager!
Mein Führer, was Sie da sagen, ist ungeheuerlich!
Die Generalität ist das Geschmeiß des deutschen Volkes! Sie ist ohne Ehre! Sie nennen sich Generale, weil Sie Jahre auf Militärakademien zugebracht haben, nur um zu lernen, wie man Messer und Gabel hält!
Oh my God.
Widerstand in den Weg gelegt. Ich hätte gut daran getan, um darin alle höheren Offiziere registrieren zu lassen, wie Stalin. Ich war nie auf einer Akademie. Doch habe ich allein. Allein habe ich das nicht.
All by myself, not daddy. No.
So Verräter. Von allem Anfang an bin ich so verraten und betrogen worden. Es wurde ein ungeheurer Verrat geübt am deutschen Volke. Aber alle diese Verräter werden bezahlen. Mit ihrem eigenen Blut werden sie bezahlen. Sie werden es saufen in ihrem eigenen Blut.
Bitte gerne. Jetzt beruhig dich.
Meine Befehle sind in den Wind gesprochen. Es ist unmöglich, unter diesen Umständen zu führen. Es ist aus. Der Krieg ist verloren. Aber wenn Sie, meine Herren, glauben, dass ich deswegen verlasse.
We interrupt this program to annoy you and make things generally irritating.
But it's more than just illegal. They're talking about kidnapping. Mm-hmm. Said I got a blank checkbook to find this guy, and they told me if I could find him within the month, they'll give me a $150,000 bonus. Mm-hmm. That's insane for a guy who's a nuisance. That don't happen.
To official.
Okay. We're just gonna. That's enough of that. I didn't know that David Wallace little clip. David Wallace is everywhere, right? Like, yeah. You can't escape him. He's just, like, always looking around. That was hilarious. I'm really sorry for people that are listening. Just go to YouTube, Blackball with James DeFiore, and find it, because it's worth watching.
It's very worth watching.
Oh, my God. And you know what's funny is that, like, 6 months ago, Cheryl, and you and Richard taught me this, that because I would, like, read emails between brethren when I was first getting stuff, and I was like, guys, what the fuck is with the way they talk? I don't understand what the fuck they're saying. Like there's certain like nouns that I was like, what is it? Like a locality was something I had to look up. Like, I felt stupid. I was like, what the fuck is a locality? Like, I don't know what that is. So I had to look that up. And the way, Peter, even tonight, the way that you used the term. And so I was, what did you say? I got shut up. And I was like, that is like, shut up was like a phrase that kids weren't allowed to say. It was like the junior of all the swear words. And it wasn't even a swear word, but your mom was like, don't tell anyone shut up. It was like, no, that's rude. And it was a policy. It's like an actual like doctrine of shutting up. Isn't it an actual doctrine?
There's another term, technical term, is confined.
Oh.
So you're confined. Yes.
So it's just like the slang, the brethren slang was the shutting up.
Yeah, like handcuffs. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's go back to the legal stuff for a second. The whole force coercion thing, because I don't know if you got this email, Cheryl, that we got from a mutual friend, but it was the court document for a case in, I think it was Vancouver, where a brethren member didn't want to have to pay union fees wherever they were working, because it conflicted with his religious beliefs as a Plymouth Brethren person. And the court ruled that it wasn't a religious belief, it was a political belief. Mm-hmm. And they denied that person the ability to get out of whatever they were trying to get out of. I think it was the paying union dues or something like that. So, you know, I know it's like incrementalism is probably the most frustrating ism, because, you know, you don't want to spend forever clawing up a hill, but sometimes that's what you have to do. Are those the kind of little cases that maybe are nibbling on the edges of what we really are trying to get to the heart at?
Go
Cheryl?
Ahead, Peter.
Either one of you, go ahead.
Yeah, like, absolutely. But I mean, I think these are just the little nuggets that really speak volumes as to what's really going on in there, right? Yeah, I didn't read the email. I remember it came up. Is that the school guard one, or the crossing guard one, or?
I don't remember the occupation. I just remember I scrolled down to the decision. Yeah, the decision was just interesting. Like they rejected a Plymouth Brethren Christian Church's members' claim that they were trying to not do something because of religious beliefs. And they're like, no, that was like, you haven't established that's a religious belief. So we believe it's a political belief.
It's good, because I think these judges are starting to kind of get a little look into what this group really is. and maybe not be so lenient. Like the one with that human rights, man, I would love to have her in front of me when I'm standing in that courtroom and be like, yeah, like she obviously hears really what this group is all about and was didn't have the wool pulled over her eyes.
Well, she did for 2 years though.
Yeah.
Speaking of union membership, here's my certificate of exemption from union membership.
No way.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Do you remember those, Cheryl?
I was 17 when I left. I never had those.
That's what I'm talking about though. Mm-hmm. Is it that's what I'm talking about, but the Canadian case version of that. They're trying to be exempt from paying union fees because they say that being in the union is against their religious beliefs. Were you able to claim it on religious beliefs though?
Yeah. I had to go before a trial. So in New Zealand when I was a youngster, you had to write a letter and say you couldn't join the union because you're a lover of the Lord Jesus and you quote some scriptures. And then some of us had to go before a tribunal and sitting in front of all these men and actually, you know, they would fire questions at us and we would, and then they'd give us this little card. Yeah.
Wow. Like, and so isn't that hilarious though? Like that's the kind of like undue power that I think religion wields in the secular world of like society, which is not supposed to be run with any like real underpinnings of religiosity of any kind. And so to be able to like thwart something that everyone's got to do in that sense, in the it's economical, it's certainly not religious. I can't think of anything that is least relevant to a union membership than religion. I just, you know, it seemed like God was more of a socialist than a capitalist, you know. He hung around with 12 dudes and washed feet and fed people. It didn't matter, you know. Like it doesn't seem like he doesn't seem like the kind of guy that would be like, you know, blessed are the union evaders, for they shall inherit the earth. Like it doesn't feel right. And well, you're still a Christian, Peter. How do you feel about the relationship between religion and politics?
Oh, that's a hard one.
Well, here, let me make it less comfortable for you.
Yeah. Well, ask me an easier question, please.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, because the listen, we're I when I come at this group in my mind, I come at it from a few different places. The things that really piss me off are obviously things like the abuse and the cover up of that abuse. And then the more technical thing, and the thing that I feel like we can grasp at to try to expose what this group is kind of all about and why I believe they're so dangerous, is the relationships that they have with politics. Is the idea that, you know, this group has completely, you know, it's statistically impossible for one group to just randomly and coincidentally receive so many fat government contracts simultaneously all over the Commonwealth.
I think they should keep their noses out of it. And they're only doing it for monetary gain. I mean, well, earlier on they were trying to influence the government against gays and things like that. Now it's a lot of it's money stuff because they want right-wing governments in for because they can handle money better, I think. But yeah, to come back to that, that was one of the questions I asked them. And right going back earlier on, I covered this in Cheryl's podcast too, actually. But I asked them some difficult questions going back like 15 years. They were telling the media that the all the politics stuff in New Zealand had nothing to do with the Brethren. It was just individual people in the church campaigning government. And yet Bruce Hales came to Wellington and had a meeting in a person's house with these seven campaigners. They were called the Secret Seven by the media.
Yeah.
I don't know if you've seen the newspaper articles. Yeah.
No, please explain like I've never heard it before, because this sounds pretty intense.
Yeah, so in 2005, I think it was, these seven brothers did a secret campaign, as that's what the Britons were doing back then under Bruce's guidance. And Bruce came to Wellington. These seven brothers met in a person's house in Wellington. And then they did all this stuff in secret. And they rented houses, because you've got to authorise it under an address. So they rented houses for an address to use, so that nobody would be able to trace it back to them. But investigators in the media, you know, investigative journalists got onto it and found out who it was, and found out it was Breslin members. And the whole thing hit the media. And anyway, these brothers agreed to have a meeting with the media. And they told the media that it had nothing to do with Australia, in other words, Bruce Hales, and it had nothing to do with the Breslin, and they were funding it themselves. And so at the time, I was a printer, and I was printing the New Zealand directory of Breslin names. And a couple of weeks later, a few weeks after this newspaper article, all the Breslin businesses were asked to subscribe to a newsletter called the SIS, which was Strategic Information Services. And it was a bunch of useless information, which was in the media anyway, which we didn't need at all. It cost several hundred dollars a month to subscribe to. And it smelt suspiciously like it was funding for this media, for this campaigning, which I think was the tune of $1.2 or $1.6 million. So I replied to the email and said, oh, is this funding for the campaigning? And I got an email back. I got an email a couple of weeks later saying, could you please give us all the files for the Breslin directory?
Wow.
They didn't tell me if it was funding for the campaign, but it obviously was.
Was this the same operation?
Told the media they were funding it themselves.
Was this the same operation, Peter, where they were basically caught investigating like the prime minister's spouse? Is that the same thing?
That's right. It was the same time. Yeah.
That is crazy. Yeah. See, that's what I'm talking about. You know, that kind of the incestuous relationship that the brethren have with politicians and how it enriches them. Like all these companies, like I don't know what it was like in New Zealand, Australia, but in the UK and Canada, certainly, a lot of these companies that secured these PPE contracts had nothing to do with that industry before the pandemic. They were like in Canada, they were selling lubricants, you know, which is like, which is metaphorical at least, but like, you know, there were all these front companies. Was it the same in Australia and New Zealand?
Yeah, but the funny thing about that is we were told in Australia, we were told in New Zealand, Mr. Bruce said, don't rush into selling PPE products, sort of stay out of that. And looking back on it, it was like he was saying, keep the fuck out of it because my family's doing that.
That's exactly what he was saying.
Yeah. You have to understand, like, Peter was still in when this was all at the beginning of COVID.
Oh, yeah. Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then when I was on my way out, one of those secret seven people was one of the people that was kicking me out. And I challenged him. I said, when Bruce Hales came to Wellington and you seven people meet him in that house in Wellington, did you talk about politics at all? Did you talk about campaigning? Mm-hmm. And he said, we take full responsibility for what we did. And I said, yeah, but did you talk about politics? And he said, we take full responsibility for what we did.
Yeah, see.
And I said, so you lied to the media, did you? Did you lie to the media then? And he said, I'm not going to tell you what we talked about.
Wow.
That's the biggest thing. They get caught in lies all the time. I'm talking with somebody very interesting right now who I'm trying to unpack all the information he's given me. But I'll give you some names after, James, to go and investigate. But this particular situation, same thing, infiltrated the politics so drastically inside a actual country that they got things taken off an essential necessity list of what would be essential and you have to have fixed prices on.
Yeah.
Because it was part of their, yeah, you probably know who I'm talking about. So it's, along with coercion control, right? We know we need that installed somehow, somewhere, some way. But the other thing is how do you get a church out of bed with the government, right? Like, how do you do that? That's a very huge task.
I think I have what I would consider, at least a step in the right direction. I talked about this with Damien Hasty because the stuff that man has uncovered is insane. Like the webs of like companies that own these shell companies that do business like with their sister organizations in Canada under the radar, no taxes, this and that, government contracts, all this stuff. And what do we see other companies getting raked over the coals for, sometimes rightfully, and frankly, sometimes not so rightfully, when the media attaches social issues to corporations, it can sometimes be the death knell of that corporation. Like that's when they put out those slobbering apologies and they donate $20 million to an organization or whatever. So attaching it to social issues, like in the Brethren's case, anti-gay, you know, why would a government want to do business with a company, with a string of companies that is run by people who are vehemently anti-gay?
Of course, they keep their mouth shut about that now. The Brethren don't.
Doesn't matter. We all know what they are. The story that just came out in Canada. What about the anti-woman angle? Why would any government want to do business with a corporation that is so demonstrably anti-woman and literally oppresses them in our society by from birth, teaching them that they're second-class citizens and all of those stupid rules that are attached to being a woman, where you can't speak without permission?
But I think if Bruce
Hales, tell that they have no Puerto Rican chicks there because there's no way they would stand for not being able to speak without permission. And thank God for that. Anyway, sorry, go ahead, Sean.
The thing is if Bruce Hales is paying enough money, right? Like if there's enough money being handed to somebody, like people don't care. They let their morals go out the window.
I don't think the media has tried it though. That's the thing. Like even the CBC, not even the CBC report fell flat for me in a few ways.
100%. Yeah.
And one of those things is that anytime the Brethren is in the news like that, the media has an opportunity to do what they would do to a corporation that I can't think of one off the top of my head right now, to be honest with you, but I am certain if, as soon as I'm done this podcast, I'll think of a half dozen examples of corporations who either went under because of a social thing or took such a massive hit that their apology tour was nauseating and like a year long. You know what I mean? But the point is that sponsors don't sponsor certain shows like, like for example, the Joe Rogan show. I'm just using that as an example. It doesn't matter if you watch them or not. But sponsors did leave. Sponsors leave Tucker Carlson. Sponsors leave these shows that are like vitriolic or whatever. This organization, if branded correctly and accurately, I don't know how a government minister would be like, Minister Robinson, you just gave a $228 million contract to a company that's never dealt with PPE ever and is run by people who systematically oppress women, documented, use coercion control to keep families apart, are anti-gay demonstrably. Why would you do that? The PR would they, and the optics behind it, I think if done right, wouldn't be able to survive it in a lot of ways. So they would at least be able to like say, okay, they've lost their government contracts because no government wants to stand in front of a microphone. If any reporter actually showed any ingenuity and bravery and answer a question like that, how did he answer that question? What do you do? Defend it? And then all of a sudden people are digging and then it permeates, or sorry, then it snowballs. And then hopefully you have something. The problem is we can't get legacy media to report like that.
No.
You know, like I was surprised to even see the story about the Human Rights Museum. It just surprised me. But why wasn't there a paragraph somewhere in the middle that was like the Plymouth Brethren Christian Church are known for being oppressive towards women and vehemently anti-gay? Why wasn't
that? Hence why they didn't want them to see the women's rights.
Correct.
Inside, right? Like, that's why they wanted that covered up.
If this was a Christian organization that was like, called the Proud Brother Christian Group, they'd be all over it.
Well, you remember what David Wallace always said, if we were to hire him as a fixer, where would he go? And he said he would have went down the LGBTQ community. He said, that's where I would have gone. That's where I would go. And so I do hope that this opens up as a door of communication. I contacted them at AGEL in Canada here. I want to sit down and talk with them. I want to join teams with them in their fight still in this. And I want to bring in what I'm trying to do, right? And what we're all trying to do. Because I do. I think that the more bodies and the more people that come together, this is what I was trying to say yet last night, is that the more of us that come together and stand up and start speaking, the more that the media might get a hold of this. But right now, there's just a few of us kind of pesky mosquitoes flying around here. I mean, hey, I could be loud.
Hey.
Well, I mean, compared to... If we had a really core group of people, you know, 500 people sitting outside protesting outside Mr. Hale or Bruce Hales's house, that's what I would do. If I was rich, I'd be in Sydney right now. I would be in Sydney and I'd be protesting out his fucking house.
I'll go to Sydney with you. Let's do that.
That's where I would be. I would be outside there.
Finance our trip to Sydney.
But I just think it's super important. The more and more people that get together, we need more Peter Harts, people who are not afraid. Like, I don't care. I don't care what badge you wear, what crown you wear, whatever you wear. I will say whatever I need to say to you, to your face, if you're not doing what you said you're going to do.
We also need, and I believe this is true in modern society, anywhere corruption exists. Mm-hmm. We need whistleblowers.
Yeah.
We need moles and whistleblowers. It's the only way these days to unearth anything, because everything has NDAs attached to it. Everything has fear attached to it. You know, and we need more people to be able to actually do damage when they leave. Like the drunk uncle at a wedding that knocks over the cake before he walks out. We need those guys. I mean, we need someone to knock over the cake, right? Like,
did you ever have to sign an NDA, Peter?
No.
No, you didn't.
No.
Is there anything that you'd like to say because of the lack of the end? What's the most egregious and accurate thing that you can tell me about the Plymouth Brethren, something that I might not know? I'm sorry to put you on the spot so much, but you know.
Oh, I don't know. Yeah, sorry. I'll just think about it.
Peter's like, how much time do you have?
I'm just so curious because he's just so, you were in it for so long. I talked to Richard about this a few times, about just the psychology of the Richard then versus the Richard now. You know, and that, because essentially, for a lot of people, the brainwashed aspect of a person that's been in before, do you feel like you were brainwashed or is that not the word that you would use?
Well, the thing for me is I had about 17 years before I came out, I knew it was all bullshit. And so I had that time to get used to it. And a lot of people that come out, like for the first 2 or 3 years they come out, they won't talk to any other leavers because they still believe they're evil people. Whereas as soon as I was out, I was ringing up people. I was, right into it. Sure, I didn't have any friends because I hadn't sort of had other people around me. I lost everything except for my business, which was great. And I made sure I got an apartment on the Wellington waterfront in the city. So there's lots of people around me because I couldn't cope with being in some flat with bush outside the window. You know, I had to have people around me.
Yeah. Okay.
And I just quickly built up a relationship of friends around me, which was easy when you go to the church. But a lot of people that leave, they're in a real mess because they won't reach out. They're just scared of everyone because they've been brainwashed. Where I had quite a while to get used to it.
So you say that, so it was like 17 years before you left, you were What happened there? Was there a situation that took place? And you're like, oh my gosh, like, how did that
work? Well, Bruce House came to prayer about that time, and I thought, yeah, he's not a man of God. He's a selfish sort of person, and I thought I don't have to believe he's a man of God. Everyone's saying you have to, and in the other podcast, I went over an incident where I asked him if I could build a house, because you weren't allowed to do anything without. You didn't have to ask Bruce. I was a bit wild, and you weren't allowed to build houses, basically. But I asked Bruce if I could build a house, which was a bit of a wild thing to do, and he said I could. It was a phone conversation. And then a few months later, when my house was almost finished, he was driving past my house because people were showing some land that they were going to build a big church on. And someone said, oh, that's Peter Hart's house. And he said, oh, I didn't say he could build a house. And that got me into a lot of shit. And I was real pissed off with him, of course, over that. That was...
Did he take it? Did he take your house?
Sorry?
Did he end up taking your house?
No, oh, okay. we stayed in it. We lived in it for 12 years. Yeah. Right early on, that sort of got me a bit offside. So I had a long time to sort of get used to the idea that there was holes in the whole rhythm thing. Whereas a lot of people get kicked out unexpectedly, I suppose you might say, and then of course I've got to cope with the whole psychological brainwashing thing, and they're in a bit of a mess.
Did you ever sort of try to figure out how much excuse me, how much money you gave to the hierarchy?
You mean personally?
Yeah, personally, your family, whatever.
I never agreed with the whole so the care meeting thing is a once a month giving.
Yeah.
Which is quite heavy giving. On a Sunday morning at the Lord's Supper, you put money into a basket. And that's like, well, as a family, you know, in New Zealand dollars, our dollars worth a bit less than yours, but as a family, we'd probably normally be expected to put like $200 in, I think.
Wow.
But we didn't do that much because I disagreed with what they were spending it on. I told my wife, giving it to all these dudes that don't need money, and they're also using it for fighting legal stuff too, which I disagreed with. So we didn't give that much. We tended to give money away otherwise.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't give away a lot of money to the church as such because I thought it was a waste of money.
You were such a maverick, it seems like, in the last 10, 15 years, weren't you? Because your insubordination and not giving money, like, I love it. I think that you set a good example. I wonder if anybody took your lead after you left.
It was actually pretty stressful. I mean, I was actually really stressed in those years because I was living a lie. I was living two lives. I was living a lie. And I ran a lot and swam. I had to get it out of my system.
Yeah,
I was pretty stressed, but I also laughed through a lot of it too. Sense of humor helped a lot,
and I think that's what you still carry today. Is it's just that underlying humor you have that is so admirable. Yeah, I love it.
Well, it was really hard living in there. You know, knowing it's a false system, and you can't just walk out because you leave everything behind, and that's what. It's so hard. You know, do you cut your losses and walk out and leave everything behind, or do you struggle on?
Yeah.
I don't know. I think it's admirable. I'm, and I know that it was stressful, and I'm not trying to downplay that part of it at all. But I think the exercise, the running and swimming, I think you were smart. You didn't, it doesn't sound like you internalized. You recognized in yourself that you needed to, you know, decompress and get something out of your system. But also the decision that you made after you left to live amongst people, I think you just, you handled it in probably the exact way that you should.
Yeah. Yeah.
So well done.
I was shocked when I found out you'd only been out for 2 years, because you don't act like somebody who's just been out for 2 years.
Imagine Peter was a mole for the Brethren, and he successfully infiltrated Blackball. I'm just kidding. Just joking.
The Brethren said to me, when I was, right at the end, they said that they sort of thought I'd been a traitor and been talking to outs for a long time and, been reading material. And I said, I've had nothing to do with people outside and I've been reading nothing. I only just contacted the person outside. I just knew they were wrong because I'd read the Bible and it was contradictory what the Bible said. And I could just see through them, just using common sense as well.
But listen, I think your story is amazing. I agree with Cheryl, and I agree with Jen Waddell in our comments, who said Peter is a badass. 100. I would agree with that assessment. You seem unassuming, but the things that you do were brave, even if it came out of a place of like honest frustration and anger and a sense of a lack of justice. Still brave, because you must have known deep down, like you were living two lives, like you said, but you must have known deep down that the ending was probably going to be difficult, right?
I think it was hard, but it sort of prepared for it. It was hard.
You should be like a recruiter of what do they call people that leave? Deserters? What do they call them? Like people that don't get forced out but just leave. What are those people called? Do they have a name, Cheryl?
Not leavers. I don't know.
Leavers. Is that what they're called? Like they call them something. I can't remember. Listen, I rely on you guys for the lingo, but there's a word for it. I think it's leavers. I think it actually is leavers. But to like recruit, like the same way that the CIA will recruit good agents, you got to like recruit people that are still in. You got to find the right one. The ones with not too much family. Do you know what I mean? And the grass is green over here, mate. You know, like something, because I don't know. We're trying to be that disruptive force. And these are the best ideas I have. I'll just shut up.
The best time to come out is a couple with children that are, in their teens or no older than 14 or 15, and they can just come out. The kids aren't too rattled by it. They lose a few friends, but they quickly make new friends.
Yeah.
That's the best time to come out. Like when I came out, I had married children who had spouses who wouldn't want to leave, and there was no way I could leave my family. But my wife was a very strong supporter of the church.
I would be thinking young couples with baby daughters. That's what I'd be thinking. Like a 6-month old daughter, and you walk up to your friend, you're like, wow, she's beautiful. It's too bad she's never going to amount to nothing, eh? Oh, fuck. Anyways, I'll see you at church, like maybe plant the seed. I don't know. I feel so bad for those people. I really do. I feel bad for Richard, who hasn't seen his children. Mm-hmm. I'm glad he's got a new bundle of joy. She's so cute. Oh my gosh.
The people are really talking in there though, right? It's being really stirred up in there and people are talking. I think it's just a matter of time before people start finding each other in there and creating their own little teams on leaving. I mean, a lot of people want to leave with their businesses intact, right? Especially if you have a business. And that's very hard to do in there. Like in Peter's case, like that's huge to be able to leave and keep your business with you. Mm. But not everybody is that it has the ability to do that. So I do think they really rely, the emails that I get, people really rely on what we're doing out here to create this runway for them to be able to get out. And so I always am sitting there with this intention of like, how do we do that, right? That's where the coercion control law comes in. We have to find a way to have these different runways out so that people can leave with their families intact, their businesses intact.
Yeah, well, the businesses are so intertwined. And that's another thing that Bruce Howes has done. Is he's brought in multiple ownership of businesses, and he said businesses combine. He said, like three separate businesses. He said directors from all the businesses have part ownership in all the other businesses. It's like a tank. So the businesses are all tangled up in multiple ownership. I mean, that's just made it so hard. And of course, all the families are intermarried, and it's just a it's such a mess. And I know there's, I'm sure there's people that would love to leave, but they can't.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And it's a mixed bag. There's people that don't have a clue what's going on. They're just happy in there. And there's other people that would love to leave, I'm sure. It's a mixed bag. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, Bruce has very strong supporters, and he's also got those that see right through him.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it's scary. It's like and I swear I'm not trying to use this analogy, but you know, like in Germany in like the 30s, people would pretend that they were supporters of the Nazis because they were afraid of what might happen to them if they said out loud, no, I think Hitler's a crazy person or whatever, you know, like,
well, that's just suicidal. I mean, you can't even tell your wife you think he's a crazy person.
Yeah.
Because she would report you.
Well, I wouldn't tell my wife anything anyways. She's I haven't done a wife joke in a while. We have to split, but listen, Peter, you can come back anytime. Honestly.
Did you get the screenshot I sent you?
Yeah, please explain what this is. This is how we'll wrap here, because you did send me this. It's pretty compelling, but I want you to explain it, because I'll butcher it if you could.
Yeah, so one of the things I said to them at the end, as I challenged them about the court cases, I found out that they were taking two prisoners to court. One of them was Braden Simmons. The other was Peter Harrison, who was an old man. He was 83. And I found out they were taken to court, and I was really annoyed about this. I thought it was so cruel. So I sent an email to Dean Howells, he's Bruce's son, because I thought, well, he's going to show up to his dad. And also Caleb Hall, who's the 2IC to Bruce Howells in New Zealand for UBT, and also a couple of men in Wellington, brothers we call them. I sent it straight after the Lord's Supper on Sunday morning, sort of for added effect. And I got this reply from Caleb Hall, who says, "Hello, Peter. Sorry for the delay in replying. You made a comment in your email about the PBCC suing ex members. I am personally not aware of this happening. Can you please elaborate a bit more?" So I knew he was just lying through his teeth.
Yeah.
And there's another email there from the brethren, from PBCC lawyers, which I wasn't aware of, just a few months earlier, to Peter Harrison, telling him he had to give up some stuff, or they would, the PBCC reserves all of its rights against you. So theory was lying through his teeth. But the other interesting thing was, we had a few exchanges between Caleb Hall and myself, and there was a bit of a gap between the exchanges. I thought at the time he's probably getting instructions from Sydney as to what to say to me. So they were obviously telling him what to say.
Yeah. Yeah.
There you go.
They speak in very PR type lingo, you know, like they have it's like lawyers in public relation firm had a baby who really liked Jesus. It would be those guys, right? Like, because nothing that they say, first of all, is true. And everything is about confidentiality to protect themselves and the crimes that they commit.
Yeah. So they were taking these ex-Brethren to court, and it was totally hidden from the Brethren. The only way I found out about it is because I contacted the person who no longer was in fellowship, and they told me about it. And so I just hit the Brethren with this and said, "I totally disagree with it. Why are you doing it? Especially an 83-year-old man."
Right.
Yeah.
And they were really cross with me, and they tried to lie about it and say it wasn't even happening.
You know, my oldest sister told me back in the spring when I contacted her about this, she told me, she said, "I have to tell you, Cheryl, that there's a lot of lies that are out there, a lot of things that are said out there, and 99.9% of them are the lies. And so we'll end this show today, and I'm going to tell the PBCC that, you know what, we are the truth, you are the 99.9% lies."
Well, that's what I was told in there. I was told all the time, "Oh, it's all lies." I don't know how many times I was told that. It's all lies. Yeah.
Yeah.
And yet, yeah, I don't find liars out here.
No, there's just one lie after another, after another, after another.
Yeah.
That's what I mean. They confess all the time in how they speak, whether it's Bruce Hales or just the way that the elders speak. It's all lies. They might as well, like, everything they say can be applied to them. And that's really, truly what narcissism is.
Yeah.
Narcissists always do that. They accuse others of doing the things that they embody, not just the things that they do, but the things that really help define them is often what they get. That's Bruce Hales warning people about con men. That's Bruce Hales using a metaphor about, like, what do you think, that there's anybody in the world where boatfuls of money just comes and lands on their lap? Well, yeah, fuckface, you. You know what I mean? It's like, you're the guy in the Zacchaeus parable, you idiot. Like, you know, like, things just come to you. You know, and you don't give to the poor because you are the poor in every analogy that you talk about. It is so interesting and horrible, you know, and I think, you know, that we should maybe do a show on that, on just the language and how language is used by elders and Bruce Hales, and how it's really just one big confessional. It really is. Listen, we have to go, but Peter, it was great meeting you. You can come back anytime, no problem. Please, I'll give you questions that are really difficult in advance so you can not provide dead air again like you did tonight. I'm just joking. I know, I really appreciate the time. And Cheryl, as always, you're like a sister now, so you can come back anytime as well. I appreciate both of you for coming tonight, and thank you very much.
Thanks, James.
Good. Thank you.
Take care.
Bye-bye. Okay.
Bye.
I know. I was a little giddy. Smoked a joint and meandered a few times. I get it. But fuck you. It's the Christmas holidays. And you know, I can't always frame the Brethren stuff in the dark way. You know, there's a time and place to not crack jokes. And obviously there's a time and place to not meander. But yeah, I had fun doing it. And Peter's such an interesting cat. And I love Cheryl so much that tonight I just had a good time. It was that Hitler thing, that Hitler meme. It changed my entire mood. I had just come back from a Christmas concert for my kids. And they are grade 3 and grade 1. And, you know, that was, you know, it was what it was. Just a bunch of really badly organized kids tripping over themselves and being cute and stuff. So that was fun. And then I come home and I'm like, okay, I'm going to do a podcast and it's going to be with Peter. Okay. You know, I was feeling good about it, but I was like, and then someone else sent me that Hitler meme thing and I just died laughing. So I decided, instead of it being like, tell me about when the brainwashed Peter finally was excommunicated from the cult. How did you feel, Peter? I didn't want it to be like that. So I smoked a joint and I regret nothing. And even this meandering screed, I don't regret shit. You guys are still listening to it. It must be at least mildly entertaining. I don't know what shows I have going on this week, except for Casual Fridays, which I'm really looking forward to. And if there's anybody in the comments that wants to be on the show, you're on. We'll see you next time on Blackballed. 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 Blackballed.